My name is Diederik Wilfer, working at the Dutch tax department. And I'm going to tell you about what kind of things we are doing at the Dutch tax department with MPS. Yesterday you heard already some things from Gert, my colleague. Today I will give you some more details and talk about also some other projects that we did. Meinte will help me with one of the demos from one of the projects on which she is working on. So the agenda which I want to follow is the following. I want to tell you something about the Dutch tax department. I want to tell you about our vision agile execution of legislation. The vision for which we need actually MPS. And I want to tell you about some of the activities that we are doing for business rules management, in which MPS is one of the more important tools to deliver. I have two examples. One is from the income tax, which is one of the largest installations that we have. The other one is a proof of concept that we are doing for what we call assertion management. And finally, I will conclude with benefits and challenges in using MPS, because also we still want some things to be enhanced. Something about the Dutch tax department. It's not only about tax, we also do benefits. We have a customs department and we have a department which do all kind of fraud detection. And of course, a large part of it is also IT. For benefits, we already use MPS for several years, from 2015 onwards. For tax collection, we started using MPS 2016, and even in customs, they are working now with MPS for creating a system to validate incoming messages. But I will focus on the top one, the tax part. Just to give you an impression about the size of the tax department, we have 30,000 employees, from which 3,000 are doing IT. We have 11 million tax returns that we get every year. We have a lot of revenues, and of course also things around customs with containers which we scan for goods that we don't want to have inside our country. To give you some impression about how much digitalization there is in the Netherlands regarding to tax, this is a graph from the income tax, in which you see that most of the income tax returns are entered through our portal, mybelastingdienst.nl. A few are entered to our app, some other software and paper you can even not see anymore on this graph because it's so small it doesn't show. So mostly everything is digitalized and all processed completely automatically, only for the things in which we suspect something is wrong. Here I have a graph in which you see all the legislation, the different types of legislation that we have to execute. You see a number of pages in the legislation that is describing the tax type. And it gives you some kind of figure on how complex this specific type of text is. You see also the complexity of the systems, yes? No, it's even more. Yeah. So it's a relative graph. Yeah. Yeah. But you can see that the number of pages and the number of money spent on IT and the size of the systems all are related to each other. Today I will show you something about our income tax, and I will show you something about wage tax, which we also have something in MPS. So let me first tell you something about this vision that we have, agile execution of legislation. We have, of course, the legislation, and every year we get a new book of all these laws. And of course, most of it is the same, but every year something changed, and every year we need to make sure that we know exactly what are the differences between those books. And currently, that's all done manually. I think it's getting thicker. Yeah, yeah. I think every year politicians are trying to reduce the number of rules, but every year it gets more. So what we think is that we, when we use this knowledge, which is already in the legislation, and we just define what our systems should do, it will be much more easier for us to change those systems also. Because currently, when we need to change the system, we need really to investigate the system and have a look which part of the system was built based on which part of the law. And the traceability between those things are currently very hard, and actually that's what we think should be better. You should know actually, or we should know actually, from every line of source code for which part of the legislation this line of code was written, and for each part of the legislation we need to know which lines of code are written because of it. And that's what we think we should do. We think we should focus on specifying based on legislation, because when we have good specifications, we can generate the code. And we think that creating those specifications is and will remain for the coming years a manual task. We can, of course, create all kind of tools and support for people who are creating specifications, but that will remain a very important task for us. All the other things we are trying to automate and to generate. So we have this vision, this it's like a process which we have in mind, and it's all focused towards creating those specifications. Because we think when specifications are good, our IT department doesn't have a problem in creating systems. Because at the time we were creating this vision, we got every day vendors to the tax department, and they said, well, we can solve all your problems when you buy this tool, or you buy this rule engine, or you buy this BPM software. And we realized that, of course, we can buy all kind of tools, but the problem is, what should we put in? How should we configure? And every time when we ask, what's the process of getting this thing this tool configured, they always said you need to hire consultants. So we think we should focus on those four steps to make sure we have good specifications, and then we can hire somebody to implement or automate the implementation. We have actually four steps. The first two are looking at the legislation or the policies and analyzing what is there, really the texts. Make sure that we know what is written there, make sure that we know the meaning. And in step three and four, we define the services that we need to deliver to citizens and companies. We have a few principles that we used when we implemented this. One of the things is make sure you know exactly what is in this legislation and use it. So don't try to design something without using the knowledge of what is already there. Make sure people, legal people, business people, and IT people can work together and create specifications in natural language. So not not in drawings, because legal people mostly like and understand well written texts. So that's why we are focusing on languages. And the other thing is that it should be integrated. Currently in our in the development of our IT systems, you see people working on processes, you see people working on data modeling, you see people working on rules. And when you try to discover what's the relation between those groups of people or the artifacts that they're creating, it's always difficult to understand, and in a lot of cases it's not consistent. And of course they have a problem to make that consistent, because it's all in different tools or mostly in Word. Of course, design decisions. And the other thing is, what we think is important is being technology independent. So the specifications are the key of our business, and the technology in which it is executed, actually it doesn't matter, because we know what it should do, and we don't care whether it's rule engine from vendor one or rule engine from vendor two. That's not important for us, and it gives a lot of freedom. For implementing this vision, we thought we should have tools for the people working in that process, because currently it's all Excel, and why should we not give those people proper tools? So we have what we call, So we have what we call an annotation environment. We created that. I will show you in the next slide how that looks like. And we think we should have something like a specification environment in which people can model rules, data models, and other things. So this this is an example of that annotation environment, that tool which we built. So you can upload your documents in there, and you can classify the words of that text, and you can connect those words at the moment they mean the same. In the legislation, it's not always clear whether two different words mean the same thing or mean different things. So that's what is made explicit here by legal people, in order to use that information later in writing the formal rules. The other thing which is important is that those words which are classified here are the anchor points for the traceability back to the legislation. So these words will be used in rules, because these words are used in rules, they can be traced back to this piece of law. So at the moment this document changes, you can compare the documents, you can see which words are new or which words were deleted, and you can see what you need to change in your specification. An example of rules, an example of specifications that we want to see are rules like this. It's all in the form of an if-then clause with all kind of conditions in which those green words are the words, the data elements, so the words from the legislation. And special things are there with words like this. So it's this is, for instance, the date, the start date of being in the military. And of course you think, okay, that's the first day that somebody is in the military, but that's not the case, because this is the first, the meaning of this is the first day in this tax year that somebody entered in the form for this year. So you need to be very aware of the meaning of all those words and the differences between the legislation, because the legislation, of course, doesn't talk about the first day or the last day. It just talks about when you're in the military, you have this duty, or you have that kind of things. Okay, let us go to this concrete example of the income tax. So we created a more detailed process, which Gert also yesterday showed, how we come from legislation to implemented services. So we have this annotation environment. We have a tool, Rule Express, which is there because our users, the people who's specifying now, like it. But the problem with this tool, Rule Express, is that it doesn't allow you to test your specifications. And we want to make sure that the specifications are 100% correct. So that's why we created Aleph, this tool based on JetBrains MPS, to make sure that we can write rules, but also write test cases and do interpretation of those rules and make sure that those rules are correct. So actually, after this step, we are sure that the specification is okay, and we can translate it to any technology that we would like. And currently we're using this rule engine, but it can be any other rule engine. And we generate not only the rules for this rule engine, but we also generate the data model for this rule engine, and we generate the test cases for this rule engine. So the test cases which we entered here and execute there in MPS, in an interpreter, we execute again here in Blaze to make sure that this implementation is 100% the same as the interpreter in MPS. And then we assume that the transformation, the generation, has been successful. So this is when you start with the legislation, but for this project of the income tax, people were afraid that when we started with the legislation, it might result in a system which does not exactly do the same as the current system. So they said, watch out, use the current specifications of this income tax system to create, based on this method, a complete new version of this system. So we took the current specifications it's 100 word documents, and we translated those documentations in rules in MPS, and then generated it to Blaze and well, tested it, of course. And it went actually quite well. Imagine that you are working with us and you are one of those guys who is responsible for making sure that that 100 word documents are consistent. I mean, that's a hell of a job. And I know that when you need to take that responsibility, it will take you around 5 years to understand the full extent of what is defined there in those 100 word documents. So this is an enormous step, an enormous improvement to make sure those documents are correct. Actually, we didn't find a lot of errors in those 100 word documents. So they do a very, very good job. Of course, because otherwise we would be in trouble with all those Dutch folks who pay taxes. Eh? And this tool which we created, we built a complete organization around it. So we have a team. It's called the Competence Center Model Driven Software Engineering. It's with people like Gert, who create, based on MPS, a tool which is called Aleph. And this tool is packaged and delivered to this other team, which is called Model Driven Rule Services. And that's a team who is responsible for implementing what we call delivery pipelines. Delivery pipelines for creating rule services. Those delivery pipelines are handed over to, let's say, the people who really know about the legislation, the real rule analysts, and they specify the rules for the income tax within Aleph. Then, of course, Aleph, this tool, generates code, and that code is handed over to the Competence Center Business Rules Management, who is actually a competence center for the Blaze Rule Engine, and they bring this code in production. So they make sure it's installed on the mainframe, and they make sure it is running and it keeps running. And they make sure that there is a service running on the mainframe or on our Linux environments, and they provide that service to the applications, which are the other applications in the income tax domain. So that's how the complete process is is working from MPS to at the end people who actually use our services in a productive production environment. Just to give you another impression about how it is working now, I have this sheet. So this is an example of a rule from that 100 word document. And you must imagine that this 100 documents are handed over to the application development department, and they create these type of rules in Word, and create again 100 documents. And of course, they have to make sure now that those 100 Word documents are the same as the other ones. And it's very nice to see these codes, because these are the unique identifiers for this data element for the application development, whereas the description is the unique identification of the data element for the functional people. And you can imagine that there might be some confusion about that. This designer from the application from the application development department gives it to the one who is building C at the moment. And this is the C code which is coming out of it. And imagine that you need to read this and understand the relation between that this and the previous document, and you can see the problem quite clearly. Actually, this is there already since 1993, and that was the system before the current system. And they just took that completely distributed system across the Netherlands, and they took the code and they integrated it in the current mainframe application, because they couldn't rebuild it at that time, because it's too complex to make sure that the results are the same, and too risky, of course, because nobody wants there to be a problem. So very conservative, like all other talks that we had today. So this is our a picture of a small part of our current system, and it's on mainframe, and it's a COBOL application. And in that COBOL application, it starts through C call. It starts Java Virtual Machine. In the Java Virtual Machine, there is a Blaze Rule Engine. And in that Blaze Rule Engine, data is get from the database. The calculation in the C modules are executed, and the data is written back again to the database. So actually what we are replacing is this part, and which is very useful, because we take it out of this mainframe system, we make a service out of it, and actually it's already live for another application which also needs this calculation, but it's of course hard to write it your own. So finally we can reuse this service also for other purposes, because currently in the app there is also a different calculation which says you cannot rely 100% on this, because we will give you the final calculation. So that's how it currently works. So what did we do? We took all those 100-word documents and we transformed it manually to our regelspraak language, the language which we defined in MPS. And it's basically that this is if-then-else, and it's transformed to if-then structures. And the same we did with all the test cases. Test cases currently in Excel, and testing that C code. And we imported those in MPS in what we call test spraak, test language, which basically means these are the input values, and this is these are the expected results of the calculation. So maybe I show you in MPS how this configuration looks like. Where is it? So remember those 100 Word documents, and those 100 Word documents you see actually here in those groups. And I took the most easy one, which is this one, and that's shown here. It's a very simple rule, which even I can understand. It's the total income tax has to be calculated as box 1 plus box 2 plus box 3. So that's a very simple rule everybody can understand. And for all those rules, we have created test cases. So this is the very simple test case for that rule, or two test cases actually, with three input values and an expected result. And I can execute this case, and it checks this test case against the rules and says, this green ball, it says it's correct. And that means, of course, that the rules and this test case are consistent, but does not mean that it is legally correct. So, of course, still somebody needs to make sure this test case is legally the correct result. Well, this is quite simple, of course, but you can imagine that our data model is quite huge. So these are all the fields, actually, which are on the text form. I never calculated how much, but it's quite a lot. So let me show you some other test cases. So this is a larger test case, which is, of course, a form which is partially filled. And you can see these are all the input variables. And then these are the expected results. Well, quite a lot. And of course, I can execute that too, which is actually built with the interpreter language. And next to it, we can see the rules which are executed. Because, of course, it's hard to tell whether when there's a problem in the test case, it's hard to tell where the problem is in the rules. So suppose we want to know something about this result. Why is this result 1194? We can search to the rule which created that. Here it is. And I can jump to that rule. And then I can see in that rule the values which are used during the execution of that test case. And then I can check whether that is what I expected. So that's really a very big help for our users. Because currently, when there is a problem in the calculation, they open 10 Word documents, take a piece of paper, and calculate it themselves now. And this, of course, is a big benefit. So I think so far about the income tax example that that I wanted to show you. This is, of course, one of our biggest text types, so that's why we were allowed to make such investments for these rules. But because we did that investment, we have now an Aleph EDA, an RCP from MPS, and it was possible to take other taxes. So we, I tried wage tax, because wage tax, of course, is calculated by our by the employees, the employers in Holland, or their payroll companies, and we create very precise specifications for those payroll companies to create their systems. And of course, every year there are problems about this document, because it's paper, it's a PDF, and there are always discussions about how to understand the semantics of this document. So we took the same Aleph implementation, and we used it also to put the rules. Oh, it's a bit slow. We also put the rules of the wage tax in it. Now we can also create Excel sheets from it, which we need to publish legally. They look like this, which can be used by payroll companies to determine how much tax they need to, how much wage tax they need to pay. Okay. Maybe back to the presentation. Yeah? We created a separate language in which we define the Excel sheet, and then we use the interpreter to create the values and process the Excel sheet. But it's rather slow. So we are planning to generate, let's say, a Java module or something from it, because it now takes a quarter of an hour to generate an Excel sheet. One Excel sheet, and we probably need to create this year 200 Excel sheets. So we need to do something about the performance, and we will use something else instead of the interpreter language to. Yeah, maybe. That's one of the options I hear today. I learned today. Yeah. Oh yeah, I need to. I forgot to tell you something, because of course we listened to. Oh, you see it. Yeah. Wrong presentation. Okay, the other thing is what we're doing is what I call assertion management. It's basically a proof of concept to. To create an administration, let's say just a database, using model-driven software engineering. The specific thing about this database is that it should support time traveling, and it should support assertions. With assertions, I mean, of course, all our citizens, they enter data through forms, but we don't consider them facts. We consider them as being assertions, and after these forms are filled in and sent to us, we check those forms and determine whether we should trust these assertions, and when we trust them, we consider them facts. So that's our basic process. And of course, it's not only our citizens that sent us those assertions, but also other parties, and they might be conflicting. So that's why we have this process in place. So what we did is we made a DSL based on fact-based modeling principles. Think about standards like the SBVR from OMG or object role modeling. We took that and implemented a DSL and extended that with assertions and time traveling. And we generate based on that DSL, we generate DB3 DDL and create web services for our mainframe. So that looks a bit like this. Our process is citizens and businesses make assertions. We analyze the risk of those assertions. We accept them, and then they become facts. And facts we can use to derive legal consequences. And Meinte will show you the MPS version of which what we created there. Meinte.
Is this on? Good. So my name is Meinte Boersma. I work at slash for slash with the tax office, specifically on this project. Next slide is... Yeah, so this is a figure of how we generate our application from this fact-based model. This is a pointer, yeah. So we start here. As Daniel already mentioned this morning, give your domain experts something in which they can write down the essence of what we're doing. So that's this thing in a sort of semi-gold, because it's the golden nugget of it all. This is the fact model in which you model belastingplichtige, which is a taxable person, things like how to identify this taxable person, and then a bunch of fact types about this this entity, and the entity is then the taxable person. You write this down in this DSL that we made, so this talks about entities and value types and fact types and such. It's rather difficult to go from this model directly to a working application. There is a bit of an impedance mismatch. Basically going from the problem domain to the solution domain. So what we figured out is that we can use a bunch of helper languages or in-between languages to make that easier. So we, for example, created the logical data model language in which you can express a database, not an SQL, but on a slightly higher level of abstraction, in which you can also add some things which SQL does not have from the get-go, things like time traveling and such. So you can define those things in a more comfortable, more higher level of abstraction way than you would be able to do in SQL. Also things like a services language we have in there. So given this fact model, we derive a language or logical data model from it, and we can also add concepts to that which are not originating directly from this fact model. Things like the concept of an assertion. Nothing in this fact model says anything about assertion, so that's something you can add in the transformation from this fact model to this logical data model. Also, you can generate services at this point. Well, once you have these models, which typically are transient models in the MPS world, you can pick those up and then generate from that to actual SQL or Java or WSDL or XSD, etc. That you plug into your actual application, and from that you can make a deployable application. So not everything in this application is actually generated. Some things you are not really worth generating, like getting access to a database and things like that. Typical boilerplate. But what is generated is everything that you can derive from this fact model. So now I'll switch to MPS, I hope, in some way, without it exploding.
Where is
the other one? Here.
Oh, yeah. Excellent. So this is our fact model. It again deals with this thing called the ZVW. You see here the definition of this entity type, which is the taxable person. We state that it's identified by burger service number, which translates very loosely to the social security number. And then we have a bunch of fact types grouped with this entity type. This is a very familiar one by now, I think, active militaire, as in active military. So this fact type, which happens to have the name active militaire, has a role-based modeling or fact-based modeling. So the taxable person plays a role there. And here is a sentence template saying that, a fact type, or this fact type expresses that the taxable person is or is not an active military. And then implicit in this is that this is true for a certain period, like from 2015 to 2018 or something like that, not necessarily a full year or a tax year. And also implicit is that is it the fact that you can say this, or anyone can assert this about a certain person. So not necessarily the taxable person itself, but also a tax inspector can say this and make an assertion about this, or for example the military can say, yeah, we have this person registered as an active military from then until then. One other thing I would like to show is that we are not shy about using the inspector. So there's a couple of extra properties associated with this fact type. And we don't provide any syntax here to keep it the syntax small and understandable, but the extra stuff goes here in this in the inspector. So now I'm going to generate this model into further down. So what we saw in the figure earlier, that's what I'm doing right now. So I switched on the transient models facility of MPS, and here you can see a bunch of models in there. So the first interesting thing is this logical data model, which is generated from the fact model. So for example, here there is an enumeration with the name fact type, and in that you see active military, and in fact there is a an entity called bewering, which is Dutch for assertion, and one of the pieces of data you can store in that entity is the data for active military. What I built is essentially a front end for what? interesting question. I don't know. could be. It's not our interest at the moment to do things like that. But yeah, probably you could perceive it as that. So once we have this as a transient model, you can derive SQL from that, and that's what we do here. So this LDM model gets translated into an actual database. So this is the create part of the DDL of the database. So and there you see, for example, I have to look it up, that there is actually a table called assertion active military. And this so this is an SQL language, which is, well, it doesn't capture all of SQL, luckily. But it captures a suitable subset of the DB2 SQL language, and DB2 has a couple of facilities for time traveling, so you can state that things have a certain business time period or a system time, things like that. So it's at the same time a subset and also a slight generalization of some aspects of DB2 SQL. Also, we generate queries in this way. So here, this is another part of that SQL language where you have queries, and this helps enormously in actually getting those queries right, because they can become quite complicated in certain circumstances. Other things we generate is, for example, an XSD to be able to put those assertions that we define into XML. So again, if we look up the active military thing, then we see that there here a complex type in which you can say that, well, this thing is this person is either active an active military or not, a certain period, and identifying data for this person. And well, once you have an XSD, you can actually build a web service with this. So this is a WSDL language that we built, and it's, again, it's a suitable subset and a slight abstraction of a WSDL for convenience reasons. So here is our main web service operation, which is to register a bunch of assertions together with some metadata, and this all is all nicely linked together. So this assertion type actually links to this complex type, which is then a choice of all the various possible assertion types in our generated XSD. Also, there is some Java generated from this through a sort of a different pipeline thing. Then we pick all of these generated files up, put it in the right place, and do some Maven magic to actually build a deployable WAR from this. And that's how we generate this particular piece of software. So it's important to note that this FEC model entirely drives the variance of the FEC model. So if you add a FEC type or an entity type, you just press generate, and the XSD will be extended, the whistle will be extended, the mappings in the web servers will be extended with that new type, etc. So you don't have to do anything manually in there anymore. Okay. Yes. Yeah. So the question is, are these all separate languages? Indeed, they are. You can, in fact, you can see them here. So we have an XSD, WSDL, SQL, LDM, and the main language is this gegeven taal. Sorry. So the question is, how do we combine these generators? We do that by having just the one generator, effectively. So we have one generator which picks up this fact model and then generates into these other languages. And these other languages are then the usual way responsible for generating text from that. Yeah, exactly. So it's. Yeah. So this is the model-to-model transformation, and then the target languages themselves do the generation to text. Yeah. So I can in fact show that very quickly because so this WSDL language was a slight abstraction of real WSDL, but here it transforms down to actual XML. Well, yeah, we define the main model transformation at the level of the data language, so this fact model, fact language. So, yeah, it's because we wrote it that way, effectively. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Time is over. Okay. Let me show you that slide. Yeah, so maybe to conclude, the benefits are that we really think it's a mature, that MPS is a mature tool at the moment, and it enables us to really quickly do prototyping and create a specification environment for specific goals. And we are also very happy that the MPS team is really supporting us in doing this. Very, very helpful. Challenges, I guess everybody already heard the challenges, also from other presentations. One of the things which I want to mention is this browser-based version, because for us it's really a pain to distribute our RCPs to end users. We need to have a virtual machine and then to get that software on it. And we regularly want to update it. Gert wants to do it every 3 weeks, so. Sorry? Of course, we use the CI stuff, but to get it on our desktop, of course, but it's very painful because we need to go through the other processes of other departments to get it installed, really. Yeah. So, Yeah, but then end users need to do it. So that's that we want to avoid. And the other thing, what is currently also a thing, is user management and authorization on the rules. That's also a thing. Currently, we need to split our GitHub repositories for that. Sorry, any? Data size, you mean the in MPS? Yeah, we also split it already, some solutions, I believe, isn't it? Yeah, it gets quite big and a bit slow. Okay. Okay. Okay, I think that was it. Yeah.